So we move on to the other the modifications or advancement that we have made in a GTAW gas tungsten arc welding is the buried TIG. Its colloquial term is buried TIG. So we also know from the physics that GTAW is a very energy inefficient process. Okay, again, we'll in this class we'll see when we calculate the melting efficiencies, we'll identify why the TIG is not efficient, because the whatever heat is generated, it's not transferred fully, isn't it? So because the cathode is heated up, cathode is heating all the heat to emit electrons, but nothing is going except the electrons from the cathode. So we have a lot of heat loss in this process, and also the convection conduction radiation would also transfer the arc to the atmosphere, the heat to the atmosphere. So in order to improve the efficiency, we need to shield the arc, isn't it? So the people thought about it, why can't we just use the plasma jet which generate at the arc core to make a cavity in such a way that in you make a weld pool and then slowly move the electrode down to the weld pool, and then this plasma jet can pull the can push the pool in such a way that the entire arc can be submerged or buried inside the pool. Okay, so this can be very effective. So for example, so in this case, so in a conventional GTAW, you always have the electrode with a distance from the liquid surface. Okay, so in that case, suppose if in conventional way, so how do you get that thing back? Okay, so in a conventional process, so you have a tungsten electrode, and this is your molten pool, isn't it? And you have an arc, right? So in that case, so the heat transfer to the atmosphere is enormous, because you also have a conduction convection radiation heat losses from the arc, and the whatever cathode is emitting, it is also like, you know, if we use an electron negative, the only electrons will be acting to heat up the workpiece. That's why the efficiency is not there. So in order to shield the arc, or not to maximize the heat transfer from the arc to the pool, so what do you do? So we slowly, once the arc is struck, we push the electrode in such a way that the plasma jet can pull the molten metal and then make a cavity by the plasma jet, and then slowly immerse it in such a way that the entire arc can be surrounded by the molten pool. Okay, so in that case, the heat transfer can be maximized, isn't it? So the conduction convection radiation can happen to the molten pool, so it would transfer the heat subsequently to the base material and then melt more, right? So by the plasma jet, what is there in the center of the arc is used to create an sort of a cavity in which the electrode can be pushed inside, and then arc can be shielded by the liquid metal, and the heat transfer can be efficiently made. So in that case, the penetration depth can be increased significantly. So only trick here is the plasma jet velocity is in such a way that it should not cause an explosion of the pool, and by carefully controlling the movement of the electrode once the arc is struck, with the proper knowledge of the plasma jet velocities, and we can create a stable buried TIG process. Okay, so in that case, the efficiency, the heat transfer efficiency from the arc to the pool is increased tremendously, and by doing so, we can increase the efficiency and we can increase the penetration. Yes, it's clear. It's very dark. Yeah, so this is also commonly used for a thicker section steel welds to minimize, especially if you are using without any filler, because it is very difficult to add filler in this case, So if you want to increase the depth of penetration and increase the productivity, obviously, so you can use the buried arctic process. Okay, good. So next advancement is like, you know, the pulse TIG and pulse GTAW, and then you can also have a pulsed plasma. And you have already, I've taught you about the how the pulsing is going to work, right? And if you look at all these processes, there are some rate controlling parameters, isn't it? So by understanding, by controlling these parameters, we can effectively control the bead geometry, microstructure, and thereby mechanical properties. Okay, so in all the advancement what you have seen, and in even the conventional process, the rate controlling factors, the important factors are, of course, current and the travel speed, isn't it? So current determines E, isn't it, the equation. So that is why I always go back to that derivation what you made. So that determines the heat generation, isn't it? And then travel speed, so obviously that is a dynamic situation. So you have a transient heat source, and the speed also controls the amount of arc energy transferred to the workpiece for a given time and given area. Okay, so these two are the primary parameters, and we also looked at how the current can be pulsed, and what role of alternating current, change in polarities, and how that can improve the stability of the arc. And in the next slides, we'll see the influence of travel speed in the heat while looking at the heat transfer and the heat input calculations. And there are some secondary parameters that can also influence the process. For example, arc length. So arc length is very critical. So the arc length is very critical because arc ignition is determined by the d, the distance, isn't it? So when you are doing it in a arc ignition by electric breakdown, we looked at breakdown voltage, right, as a function of pressure and then the distance, right? So it influences the arc ignition. And the arc length can also be fairly play around to change the heat energy. So why? If you change the arc length, so what happens to the voltage? So voltage increases, isn't it? But if you increase the voltage, you also change the heat input, isn't it? The heat input, how do you calculate again? What is the heat input equation? Efficiency, voltage, current by welding speed. So in this case, the V, the voltage, if we change, we also change the heat input. And if you change the arc length, the voltage also changes because you also change the distance. Okay, so you also change the distance, that means that the voltage should change. But there is a critical limit. Because if you keep on increasing the distance, at some point of time you also cause the arc instability, because ultimately arc is stable by sustained discharge, isn't it? And discharge has to be sustained over a distance. You cannot keep on increasing the voltage, so then you would end up affecting the stability of the arc. So we can't play around with the voltage, the arc length. That is why when during welding, when you are doing the arc welding process, the rate controlling is always current. Okay, so voltage is a derived product, right? So you cannot really play around with the voltage, because voltage is the byproduct. The current is the rate controlling. Okay, so the arc length you can play around, you can change, but the voltage will also change when you change the arc length, right? And you can't change it significantly to improve the heat energy, the arc energy, then you would affect the arc stability, right? And then polarity, polarity can significantly change the heat transfer. We already looked at the change in polarity. If it is electronegative, okay, it is the most conventionally used polarity for GTAW, isn't it? If it is electronegative, you transfer the maximum heat to the workpiece, because electrons are transferred from the cathode, which is electrode, which is negative terminal, to the workpiece, which is positive terminal. So the polarity can significantly change again the heat transfer. And the shielding gas, we also looked at in a very detailed shielding gas, is not it? The effect of shielding gases, the argon, helium, how the heat transfer change, oxidability change, changes as a function of composition of shielding gases, how we can play around the composition to get the well bead characteristics changed. And then we also looked at electrode angle, is not it? The influence of electrode angle on the depth of penetration, because if you change the electrode angle, you also change the cathode spot, is not it? So the cathode spot is changed, then you also change the arc envelope dimensions, right? And then filler addition, that can also be effectively used to change the melt pool temperature. Okay, so whether if you are using a cold wire or a hot wire, and if you are dipping it into the melt pool, the melt pool temperature can be changed, but it is not really rate controlling. But when you have a GTAW with filler, then you can also play around with the filler additions rate to change the melt pool temperature. So these are all the important rate controlling parameters when you are doing GTAW. So two process primary parameters are current and travel speed, okay, and other things are all stationary, the secondary parameters, arc length, polarity, shielding gas, electrode angle, filler additions. So generally we keep secondary parameters constant for a given application, and we play around current and travel speed, right? It's clear? Okay. So basically, so you play around current and travel speed by keeping secondary parameter constant to achieve a good weld. So such a process map we can generate, which can tell so what current and what travel speed can give us very sound weld bead, right? For a given secondary parameter, as well as the material thickness and composition. So if the travel speed is too low and the welding current is too low, we may end up not forming any weld at all. Okay, so suppose if you have a low current and high travel speed, so you may have undercuts. Undercuts means the weld bevel is not fully filled, isn't it? So suppose you have a bevel something like that, and if you have very low current, isn't it, and then high travel speed, so it may not, you may not have weld at all. So you may have something like this, and you will have serious undercuts, right? So if you have very high current, very slow speed, you melt more, isn't it? So you'll end up making humping, which is also not needed. So by increasing current tremendously at a slow travel speed, that is the melt volume, the amount of material you melt is increased. So you'll end up melting more and forming humps. So you need to play around with these the primary parameters, speed and welding current, to get very good sound weld bead. Yes, it's clear. So that's how we always get, we generate such a process maps for a given secondary parameter and the material composition and thickness, and we can get such a process maps to identify so what welding current and travel speed will have to operate. And these information, they are already there. Suppose if you are buying a most advanced microprocessor controlled power source, and they have all inbuilt parameters in the synergy, power source board, because we pay for that, right? So the commercial power source manufacturer, they do all these experiments for us, and then you select one program. For example, I want to weld say 2 mm thick austenitic stainless steel in bead on plate configuration in autogenous mode, then you can choose the voltage and current and the travel speed in such a way that the weld is made with good characteristics, right? So with this we will finish GTAW.